गुड मॉर्निंग, वी विल स्टार्ट द डिस्कशन। कैन यू सी माई स्क्रीन?
यस।
ओके, सो we are discussing about finite volume method in the last few classes, and at first what we have done, we have seen at first how to derive how to discretize a governing equation using finite volume method for a 1D case, and for a simpler governing equations like 1D heat conduction with source term. What will happen in the means in complex cases is that the process will remain similar, but the value of the coefficients and the number of neighboring points will change. Otherwise, the process will remain exactly similar. And we have seen that we have seen that we can write the discretized equation in the form of the value at that point, at a point in which we are interested, at a grid point in which we are interested, and its neighboring points, and in terms of coefficients of those points, where the coefficients will be known values in terms of, say, conductivity, interface conductivity, and geometric parameters. Source term also gives rise to another term called B, which also will be known value. So this we have seen, and then we have discussed about how to tackle the like the different aspects of deriving this equation, starting with profile assumption, then how to derive interface conductivity. We have seen the interface conductivity, it is better to take the conductivity as a harmonic mean. Then we have also seen like when we will call a discretized equation to be physically consistent, and whether it satisfies overall balance or not. So for finite volume method, it will automatically satisfy overall balance, because we are deriving the discretized equation by integrating the governing equation over the entire volume and over each control volume. Okay, not over the entire volume, over each control volume. So that's why it will satisfy. And then we have discussed how to take into account a linear source term, linear function of, say, variable temperature instead of a constant function, linear function, and it will give rise to some modification in the coefficient. Ultimately, the equation will look same, but the coefficient of the term Tp will change to, will have this additional term minus delta minus Sp into delta x, which comes from the which is the coefficient of the linear term in the source term. Nonlinear term we will see today. So after this, we have briefly discussed about some of the basic guidelines for finite volume discretization. One of the most important is that the fluxes at this control volume phases should be continuous, means there should be physical consistency in the fluxes that we calculate after discretization. Obviously, in real life it is continuous, but our discretized method should also give continuous fluxes. So it means that the heat transfer going from one control volume to the next control volume should be same. Obviously, it has to be same. If our calculation method gives different heat flux on one side and different heat flux on the other side, then it is wrong. Okay. Then some other points we have seen basically guidelines. Instead of saying rules, we can say that they are guidelines. So the coefficients of the discretized equation must be of the same sign. It may work without being of the same sign, but it may lead to unphysical situations, as we have discussed, if the sign is opposite. Okay. Another point was that the SP must be negative if the source term is linearized. We will come to this, what is linearization. But why SP must be negative, that we have seen. Because then we can ensure that the, like for example, in this case, we can ensure that the AP remains positive if SP is negative, and AE and AW will be positive, so all the terms will be positive. So B also is, if this is negative, it does not matter. The coefficients has to be positive. Okay, this constant term does not matter. So, and one more we have seen was that if a linear governing differential equation is discretized, linear, not non-linear, okay, that is important. Then if T is a solution, T means the temperature field in the entire domain, like all at all the grid points, different values of T is a solution. Then if I add a constant to all these values, then that will also be a solution. But this constant, so there will be an infinite solution, but we have to find the particular solution by using the boundary condition. Once you use the boundary condition, the solution remains fixed. So now we will discuss about treatment of nonlinear source terms. Okay. So let us try to look at certain examples. Okay. So this is known as linearization of source term. If I have a nonlinear source term, I want to express it still in this form, S is equal to SC plus SPTP. Why I would like to express in this form? Because we have seen that if you use this form, we can get this discretized equation, which will be of same form as the as with a constant source term case. Okay, so only the variable means the coefficient values will change. So we will be able to solve it using any method that we use for solving a set of algebraic equations. So if there are n algebraic equations and n unknowns, whatever method we use to solve those equations for getting those unknowns, we can use that on this also. So we want to write this in this form. Okay. Even if the source term is nonlinear, means there is a dependence on nonlinear dependence on temperature. Okay. For example, S is equal to sigma T to the power 4. So in those type of situations, what is to be done? We want to know how to find the values of SC and SP in that case. Okay. Let us start with a very few simple examples. Say S is equal to 3. It is given that S is equal to 3 with some units. Okay. So here there is no issue, obviously. We will take SC to be equal to 3 because this is a constant value. And the linear dependence on TP is 0. TP means for the pth grid point. Okay, in general it is the equation T, but for the pth grid point, the source term will depend on the temperature at that grid point. So there is no dependence on temperature, so SP we can take as 0. Second case, let us take a look. S is equal to 3 minus 4 T. Okay, again naturally you will say that we can take SC is equal to 3 because this is the constant term, and SP is equal to minus 4 because this is the term coefficient of the linear term, okay, linear dependence means. So SC is equal to 3, SP is equal to minus 4. For this grid point, the source term will be 3 minus 4 TP because temperature here is TP. So here SC will be, so we can write this as S is equal to SC plus SP TP. For this grid point, okay, so 3 minus 4 TP. But this is not the only unique choice. Okay, so we can also take, for example, everything within the constant term. How will we take everything within the constant term? By assuming that we already know the value of TP. Okay. If you take the first case like this, it is for the case where TP is unknown. It will take part in the equation, and we will try to solve for TP. But if we use the previous time step value of TP, so we will know the previous time step value. If the time steps are very small, we will know the previous time step value. And if we use that, we don't need that extra term because in the SC itself we can because everything is known in the SC, we can put everything together. So I can also write this as 3 minus 4 TP star, okay, like this. And for SP, I will take 0 because I will assume that there is no dependence on the current time step temperature. Okay. So everything we have lumped together in the constant term by using previous iteration value, previous time step value. So ATP is the previous time step or previous iteration value depending on the situation. So if it is a like iterative process, it is just the previous iteration value. So this type of approach is useful if the source term is very complicated. So if you are unable to linearize a source term, say it's a very complex source term, it's dependent on log of temperature, exponential of temperature, some other things are there, square roots, things like that, okay, or a complicated, say, T log T or T exponent T, something like that. It might be difficult to linearize, even solving might be difficult. Then we just lump everything in the constant term and assume that there is no linear dependence. So this will also work. Okay. The only thing is that convergence rate will be somewhat different. So otherwise, this will also work. It will take more time to converge, obviously, because we are not getting the exact profile of the source term. This is also known as the lazy approach, because if I don't want to worry too much and just want to quickly write a code, I will dump everything together in the constant source term, taking SP equal to 0. Although first choice is the better choice because it will lead to faster solution. These two are not also the only unique solution or only unique choices. We can take any infinite number of choices are possible. For example, another example is I have shown here. I can take SC is equal to 3 plus 2 TP square. Okay. Remember what is the value? 3 minus 40. So instead of that, I am taking here SP to be minus 6 instead of minus 4. I am taking to be minus 6. And as a result to balance, I am taking 3 plus 2 TP star here. So SC becomes 3 plus 2 TP star, SP is equal to minus 6. So this is, what does this mean? It means that instead of the slope being, so what is SP basically? It is the slope of the line, right? It is the coefficient of the linear term T. So it is the slope of the source term with respect to temperature, like in the plot. Okay. We are taking a steeper source term. We are taking a steeper S versus T curve than the actual case. This will slow down the rate of convergence. Okay. But in many cases, this is also desirable. If you have a highly, say, in this case, it is not necessary, but if you have a highly non-linear problem, you want the convergence to be slowed down. Okay. Remember that we have clarified before that rate of convergence and ability to converge are two entirely different things. Okay. So we can slow down the rate of convergence, but we can increase the chances of convergence. On the other hand, we can speed up the convergence, rate of convergence, but actually chances of convergence may decrease. The problem may diverge. So this slowing down the rate of convergence many times leads to better chance of getting convergence. So we want to slow down the convergence. There are other methods of slowing down the convergence, like we use relaxation factor, under relaxation factor. Okay. So similarly, this will also slow down the convergence. If it is not necessary, we should go with the first choice. Any questions? Particularly from the students who have not taken CFD, because these things have been taught in the CFD course. Yeah. Even if you are an old student also, you can ask, obviously. So then, if there are no questions, let us look at another example. Okay. S plus 340. Okay. So in this case, we did not discuss, but SP was negative. And if you remember the rules that we have set, if the source term is linear, SP must be negative. Negative or zero also is fine. Okay. Because zero will not lead to that. Zero will not lead to this equation. If this term is zero, there is no problem. The other terms are positive. Okay. Okay. Only if this term is positive, it may become, this AP may become negative. Not for all cases, but sometimes it may become if the SP is very large. So there was no problem. SP negative, this is fine. This is fine. SP zero, this is fine. All these cases are fine. Okay. What about this case? S is equal to 3 plus 40. Okay. So here, if we write S equal to 3 and SP equal to 4, which occurs to us naturally. Naturally, we will think that okay, the factor for T is 4, so we will take that as SP equal to 4 and S equal to 3. This means that SP is positive and AP may become negative. So this is not acceptable. Although it looks natural, it is not acceptable. Okay. So what is the next best option? Next best option is to take the lazy approach. Okay. SC is equal to 3 plus 4 TP star and SP equal to 0. This will work because there is no chance of the AP becoming negative. And we will use previous iteration value dumped together. So for this type of situation, this is the practice. So this is normally followed. Okay. Again, there may be other infinite number of choices. For example, we can take a more negative slope instead of zero slope. So SC is equal to 3 plus 6 TP star and SP equal to minus 2. Okay. Again, breaking the, this 40 into 6 TP star minus 2 TP. This can be used to slow down the rate of convergence. So this situation also we have seen. So let us now take a look at some nonlinear functions of T. S is equal to 3 minus 40 cube. Every year I give this example, but any other examples also you should be able to do if asked in the exam. For example, if I have a radiation source term. Radiation source term is proportional to T to the power 4. So there we need linearization, source term linearization, right? In practical problems, we need. So, if I am solving a say problem regarding a say very heated substance which is kept in the air, how fast it will cool using CFD there, or say heated gas is there, so entire body of the gas will radiate heat. So that has to be included as a source term. In those cases, linearization is required. So anyway, again, you can use the lazy approach. S is equal to 3 minus 4 TP star Q, dumping everything, whatever is there in the SC, and taking SP equal to 0. So this will work. Okay, this will work, but there is a better solution. Why there is a better solution? Because this approximates the source term up to the constant term. Means it does not approximate correctly the slope of the source term with respect to T, but the value at the exact point TP, it is approximating correctly. So if we can have a source term which also approximates the value plus the slope at the point TP, okay, correct slope, then it will be a better source term. For example, it will be like these cases, S equal to 3 and SP equal to minus 4. So that has correctly captured the correct slope. Okay, so we want to get the correct slope. Okay, if you are not interested in speed, slowing down the convergence. So this is known as linearization. Okay. So for this, let us consider any source term, arbitrary. This is an arbitrary source term, okay, which is a function of T. S versus T. Okay. At the point where T is equal to TP star, okay, for the pth grid point, T is equal to TP star, we can obviously calculate the source term. Say for this case, it is 3 minus 4 TP star Q. Okay. For the point TP star. For other points, obviously, it will be other values depending on what is T. Okay. If it is for TE, if I calculate, it will be 4 minus TE is Q. So, I will keep this diagram open here. Okay. So we can make the linearization more accurate by also representing the first order derivative correctly. Okay, means the slope you are capturing correctly. So to capture this slope correctly, let us consider a point which is a small distance away from S. star. Okay, this is a star. At TP star, we will consider a point which is a small distance away. Okay, this point. At some value t, where the value of source term is s. Okay, this value is t and this value is s. Source term. So we can assume that in between, because this is a very small distance, it is almost linear. Okay, in that case I can write this as s minus s star is equal to the slope of this line ds dt at this point. Okay, slope at this point, because at the other point you don't know that t is equal to tp star, this slope, into t minus tp star. Okay, so s minus s star. So this distance is equal to the slope into this distance, t minus tp star. So this is known as linearization, and with actual example, if you see, then it will become more clear how to use this. Okay. Basically, we are assuming that we are capturing the slope also correctly. Okay. So what will be the final form of the source term? That will depend on the values of s. Okay, how it depends on t. Let us take a look at our example. So s is equal to 3 minus 40 cube. Okay. This equation you keep in mind. S is equal to 3 minus 40 cube. So for the point TP star, we can write S to be equal. For the point TP, where the value is TP star, we can write the S is equal to 3 minus 4 TP star cube. Okay. Using known value, previous iteration value. That's why I am using S star. Okay. So ds dt now from S, if we take a derivative with respect to t, is equal to minus 12 t star, t square. Okay. So ds dt at t equal to tp star, for the value of tp star, where tp star is the known value, ds dt is equal to minus 12 tp star square. Okay. So now we will use this equation. S minus S star is equal to ds dt t at t equal to tp star, t minus tp star. Okay. The same equation. S minus S star is equal to ds dt t is equal to tp star, t minus tp star. So here, what is the value of ds dt at t equal to tp star? We have calculated this to be equal to minus 12 tp star square. Okay. So let us replace this. S minus S star is equal to minus 12 tp star square, t minus tp star. So now replace the value of S star. What is S star? 3 minus 4 tp star cube. So S minus 3 minus 4 tp star cube, then minus 12 tp star square into t, and minus 12 tp star square into minus tp star. So plus 12 tp star cube. Okay. So now you can rearrange the term. So S, keeping S on the one side, the source term, take all the other terms in the other, to the other side. So it becomes plus 3. And this plus term on the other side becomes minus 4 tp star cube. We already have a plus 12 tp star cube. So we have plus 8 tp star cube. Okay. Because this is already known, we will put this in the SC part. And we have a linear dependence term here. Okay. So this term we will put in the SP part. Minus 12 tp star square t. Okay. So this is similar to SC, S is equal to SC plus SP tp, where SC is equal to 3 plus 8 tp star cube. Tp star cube is known, because tp is known from previous iteration. And SP is minus 12 tp star square, which is the coefficient of t. T is the unknown, okay? So it's the coefficient of t. So it is of similar from what we have obtained previously, S is equal to SC plus SP tp. And if we use this, we will get the same equation like this. AP is equal to AT, APTP is equal to AT plus AW TW plus B, where AP is equal to AE plus AW minus SP delta X, and B is SC delta X. And SC will be known, because SC is 3 plus 8 TP star Q, where TP star is the previous situation value, so it is known. And SP will be known, because SP is equal to minus 12 TP star square. Okay. So it is also known. This way we can more accurately capture the source term, leading to better convergence. So this is a better approximation of linearized S. Any questions? this type of problems, small problems, you should be able to tackle and can be expected in the exam. Like if there is a radiative heat transfer case where the source term is say sigma epsilon T to the power 4 minus T surrounding to the power 4, where T surrounding is known but T is unknown. How to linearize it? So that type of situation should be clear to you. Keep this open here. So here SP was negative, so that is there is no issue with that also. Okay, we are happy with that. So what about another source term? S is equal to 3 plus 4 T cube. Okay, instead of 3 minus 4 T cube, we will be using 3 plus 4 T cube. If you do the same process again, S star is equal to 3 plus 4 Tp star Q, and ds dt at t equal to Tp star is equal to, so if you take ds dt, it is 12 t square. So for t is equal to Tp star, it is 12 Tp star square. Again, replace the value S minus S star. So S minus 3 plus 4 Tp star Q is equal to 12 Tp star square T minus Tp star. Okay, using this. So this leads to S is equal to 3. So this will go to the other side and become plus 4 Tp star Q, and we have already have a minus 12 Tp star Q. So it will be minus 8 Tp star Q. 3 minus 8 Tp star Q. So this can be SC. Okay. And this term will lead to plus 12 Tp star square T. So this term will be the linear term. So SP will be 12 Tp star square. Okay. So this will not work. Obviously, this is not going to work because SP is positive. So what will we do in this case? What is our option? Because linearization is not working. What is the next best option?
Yes, sir, the lazy approach which we are
using. So we will put everything in the constant term, dump everything in the constant term. It will it is the best approach because there is no other option. Means there are other options. You can take even more negative slope to slow down the convergence, but because the curve here itself it will be positive, it's just taking the lazy approach. So mathematically, remember that mathematically we can always perform source term linearization. Because whatever is the equation, I can just take a derivative and find out what is SC and SP. But it does not mean that this is always going to be the correct choice. Okay. So mathematically we can always perform source term linearization, but the linearized form may or may not work. So we have to check whether SP is less than 0 or not. Okay, less than equal to 0 or not. If it does not, if it is positive, then we have to ignore this and we have to go for the next best approach. So for S is equal to 3 plus 4 T star T cube, best option is S is equal to 3 plus 4 T P star Q and SP equal to SC equal to this and SP equal to 0. Any questions? So try a few cases, okay. You just select a few on your own, okay. I'm not giving any, but anything you can take. Some square term, some cubic term, something like logarithmic, exponential, and try whether you can do a source term linearize correctly. Okay. Later on, after the class. So now, one more thing is important. Okay, just wait for a second, please. Yes. Can you still hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we have seen many aspects of that finite volume equation that initially we had derived. Okay, we have seen how to find the coefficients, how to use the profile assumption, how to take interface conductivity, how to treat the source term, if it is a constant source term, if it is a linear source term. Now we have seen if it is a non-linear source term. One thing we have not yet discussed is, while doing all these calculations or derivation, not here, but just a second. So while doing all these calculations, we have taken the grid points to be internal grid points. Okay. So these are all the whatever we have discussed are for internal grid points which have well-defined neighbors, east and west. Okay. So the effect of boundary condition is not directly taken into the equation here because none of the neighboring control volumes are boundary at the boundary. Okay, we are this derivation was for the internal grid point. So how to take the boundary condition into the equation? Into the equation. So this will be only valid for the control volumes which are near to the boundary. How to treat those control volumes? Okay. Remember what is our ultimate objective? Ultimate objective is to get an equation of this form. APTP equal to AET plus AWTW plus B. Why we are interested in this form? Because for n control volumes, we will have n unknowns and n equations, and we will then solve them simultaneously to get the values of those n unknowns. Okay. So using any method, similar to finite difference equation, they are also n unknowns and n equations. So we have to find out using any method in unknown values. And these methods we will discuss from the next class, okay, and will not be part of the syllabus, but at this point it is just, it suffices to know that there are processes to find out, to solve n equations for n unknowns, okay, in an efficient way, okay, so that it takes, instead of using brute force. So anyway, the final thing that was left is how to treat the boundary condition. Okay, so for boundary grid points, so we will see different types of boundary condition, how those are treated. Okay, and ultimately our aim, remember, again is to put in this form, the equation in this form. Okay, APTP is equal to AET plus AWTW plus B. Okay, because then I can supply to our solver what are the coefficients of the actual grid points. So say if this is TI, for a one-dimensional case. So I can supply the coefficient AI and then AI plus 1, which is for the TI plus 1 grid point. And for I minus 1 grid point, AI minus 1 and BI for the TI grid point. And then automatically the solver will take those values and try to solve. So let us take the first example where the boundary values are given. Okay, like constant temperatures are given at the boundary, or constant velocities are given at the boundary. So whatever is the equation, which the variable which we are trying to solve for, the values themselves are given. Okay, the values themselves are given at the boundaries. So what will happen in that case? For internal grid points, there is no issue again. The equation for any internal grid points. So internal means the neighboring is not a boundary. Okay. So 3, 4, and 5 are internal grid points in this case. But for 3, 4, and 5, there is no issue. Okay, we will just use our same procedure and find APTP equal to AET plus AWTW plus B. For 3, the neighboring, so east will be 4 and west will be 2. For 4, east will be 5 and west will be 3. And for 5, east will be 6 and west will be 4. So 3 unknowns, 3 equations will be there. But what about these 2 unknowns? At 2 and 6, that is also unknown that we want to know, because the temperature at the boundary is given here, right, at these points. Okay, the grid point values are still unknown. We need 2 more equations for these 2 unknowns. Okay, so how to tackle that? So for this grid point, we can write this as equation as A2T2, means we can derive by integrating. Okay, I will show you in the next point how to integrate. So A2T2 is equal to A3T3 plus A1T1, where T1 is given. And what will be the value of A1? So typically we have the value as KE by delta XE, okay, or KW by delta XW. So in this case, this will be the conductivity at this point. And delta XW, instead of delta XW, we will have now half of delta X, okay, because the distance is half. So to calculate the heat flux here, we have to use that, okay. And the K dt dx when you integrate, so accordingly you have to calculate. So A1 will be known, you can calculate that. So A1 T1 entirely will be known because T1 is already given to us. T1 is equal to Ta, okay. So because this is already known, we will not put it as part of the equation, means unknowns. We will put it together with B, which is the source term, which is known. So the source term will get modified to B dash. If there is no source term, it will become the source term. Okay. So ultimately, the equation will come in the form A2T2 equal to A3T3, where T2 and T3 are the unknown, plus B dash. B dash is known. A2 is known and A3 is also known. Okay. So one more equation we get for this grid point, where the T2 is unknown. And so this equation, if I consider 2 as P, so TP is this point, T east will be this point 3, and the coefficient of west is actually 0, because means while supplying it to the solver. So if this is the ith grid point, because I will vary when you are solving, I will vary from 2 to 6. So if for I equal to 2, AI will be this value, A2, AI plus 1 will be this value, and AI minus 1 will be 0, because there is no term corresponding to T1. Okay. Similarly, for the other side also we can do. So for I equal to 6, AI will be A6, which you can easily calculate using this, like it will be like this. AI minus 1 is equal to A5, and AI plus 1 will be 0, because automatically this point is known, this value is known, it will go into the source term. So this is easy to tackle. Okay. So the next example is, the flux is given at the boundary. Instead of the constant temperature, the flux is known. Okay. For example, for energy equation, the heat flux is known. For other equations, similarly, if the species equation, the mass flux is known. Momentum flux is known for the Navier-Stokes equation. So flux, what is flux? Flux is Q double dash at x equal to L. This is the heat flux. Okay. So say for this point it is known, and here temperature is given. So this we already know. So what will happen for this point? Okay. So what is the situation here? Situation is that the temperature is not known at 7, because flux is known. We don't know the temperature. Temperature can change if the flux changes, right? So temperature itself is unknown even at this point also. So now I can take another half control volume, okay, besides this full control volume, another half control volume. So when you are solving for the full control volume, there is no issue, because you need the interface flux here and the interface flux here. Okay, I can draw, right? So we need the interface flux here. And the interface flux here, which interface flux here also is known. So for this sixth control volume, there is no issue. But if I take another control volume, seventh, means for this corresponding to grid point 7, which is a half control volume, and this is our governing equation, d dx of k dt dx plus s equal to 0, I can integrate over the half control volume going from 6 to 7. So going from 6 to 7, d dx of k dt dx dx plus 6 to 7 s dx equal to 0. This is what we have done previously also, right? We have integrated. We have integrated over the full control volume in the case, going from east to west, west to east. Here west is this 0.6 and east is this 0.7. So we can write this as k dt dx at 7. We will open this diagram. K dt dx at 7 if you do the integral, minus k dt dx at 6 plus this integral is nothing but if you, this is s into delta x by 2, if it is a constant s. Now k dt dx at 7, what is q? Q can be written as minus k dt dx at 7, right? Because that is the equation for flux. Into area, if it there was an area, but it's a 1D problem, so it is minus k dt dx at 7. So k dt dx at 7 is equal to minus q double dash, which is given to us. This is a known quantity. Okay, this is given to us. And this term, k dt dx at 6, we can calculate as, for this half control volume as, minus k T7 minus T6 by delta x by 2. Okay, because this is half control volume. So basically minus k t at this point minus t at this point by this distance. That is how we are calculating dt dx, at 6, and we will have to use the conductivity at 6, okay, which will be known from the grid point value. Plus s delta x equal to 0. S delta x by 2 equal to 0. So ultimately, because this is known, we can accommodate this with the source term. So our source term will again become some other value. Let us call this as b dash. This b dash is not this b dash. Okay, this is a different b dash. And there is no term which has the T8 value. So there is no problem. Okay. So only terms are for the 7 and 6. Okay. So I can write this, I can rearrange the terms, and I can write this as A7 T7 is equal to A6 T6 plus B dash. Okay. So this will be an extra equation. So now instead of solving for 5 internal grid points and 5 equations, I will have to solve for 6 points. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So 6 unknowns, and there will be 6 equations, because this extra equation will be there. So 6 unknowns and 6 equations will be there. And again, exactly same method I will use. Okay. So this equation is again exactly of the same form, APTP equal to AT plus AWTW plus B, where A is 0. Okay. So for I equal to 7, I will have AI is equal to A7, AI plus 1 is 0, and AI minus 1 is A6. B is equal to B7, BI equal to B7. So we know now how to incorporate that. Ultimately, we are just trying to find this form, because when you send the values to the solver does not understand whether it's a boundary point or whether it's any. It will just run the loop from whatever you tell it to. So if you want to run the loop from I is equal to 2 to n, it will run it accordingly. If you tell it to run from I is equal to 1 to n, it will run accordingly. If you tell it to run from I is equal to 2 to n minus 1, it will run accordingly. So for this case, when heat flux is given, I have to run till the end point. So 2 to n. Okay, if both sides heat flux were given, I would run from I is equal to 1 to n. If both sides temperatures are given, I will run the loop from I is equal to 2 to n minus 1. Any questions? Let us look at the third type of boundary condition. Okay, we have looked at constant value and given heat flux. Third is that the heat flux also is not given, but it is given in terms of some convective type of source, a mixed boundary condition. Okay, so for example, it is given that at the boundary, here I have taken a different domain, but you could have done with 6 like this also. Just while drawing, it become an extra control volume. Anyway, at this boundary, the condition given is minus k dt dx at x equal to, means the heat flux at this point, conductive heat flux internally, is equal to the convective heat flux. H at T A x equal to L, means x equal to L is this point. So at this point, H T minus T infinity. But T infinity is the temperature of the fluid. Okay. So this is the equal to the conductive heat loss. Okay. Minus k dt dx is equal to H T minus T infinity. So for this mixed boundary condition, how will we tackle? Because now the heat flux also is not given. Why it is not given? Because I cannot substitute this value k dt dx here as q double dash, because if I substitute this as h t minus t infinity, this t will be unknown. This t is not known. This is also unknown temperature at the boundary, right? So what we will do here in this case, Again, we will follow the same logic and same pattern. We'll start with the half control volume. Okay. So going from 7 to 8. In this case, the half control volume is 7 to 8 because I have taken one extra grid point. So d dx of k dt dx plus s equal to 0. Integrating over the half control volume, we will get from 7 to 8 d dx of k dt dx dx from plus from 7 to 8 s dx equal to 0. So we'll get k dt dx at 8 minus k dt dx at 7 plus s delta x by 2 equal to 0. Exactly same thing. Okay. Now k dt dx at 8 is the boundary flux. Okay. So this is equal to minus q double dash at x equal to l, similar to previously. And k dt dx at 7, this we can just represent in terms of the grid point values 7 and 8, t at 7 and 8. So this will be minus k, say same thing. This is the exact same thing. Minus k t8 minus t7 by delta x by 2, okay, for this half control volume, plus s into delta x by 2 equal to 0. So now this is again unknown, because this previously it was known, but here it is unknown. So this is equal to, so this is the negative of the heat flux. So negative of the heat flux is equal to minus h t8, because t at x equal to l is t8, minus h t8 minus t infinity. T infinity is given to us, it is known. Okay, so this is known, this is the unknown, t8 is unknown. Minus 2k delta x t8 minus t7 plus s delta x by 2. So again, we have found a form where we have t7 and t8, but nothing there on the downstream side. Okay. So we can now rearrange the term, and we will, instead of a8, means instead of similar term, instead of this type of term, we'll just get a modified value, because this h will also come into the equation. So now a8 will be 2k by delta x minus, so it will go to the other direction, 2k by delta x plus h. Okay, so this will be a dash, we can call it as a dash, or you can call it as a8 also, it's the new value of coefficient. Okay, t8 is equal to a7 t7, which is exactly like similar case, plus b dash equal to 0. B dash will have the infinite term. Just a second, just hold for a second. Okay, let us continue. So exactly again the same form we are obtaining, right? Like this, APTP equal to AET plus AWTW plus B equal to Z, sorry, plus B. Okay, so where for if I is equal to 8, you have AI is equal to this value, AI minus 1 is equal to this value, AI plus 1 is 0, and BI is this value. Okay. Similar to previously, and B dash has this term, HT in T infinity, minus HT infinity, okay, or plus HT infinity, sorry, will be there, B dash. So again, the form is same, and again, you will have to solve up to N grid point instead of N minus 1. So even if at this side also it is given, you have to solve from I is equal to 1 to I is equal to N. Okay. And just pass on the values to the solver and it will be solved. So this is how we take the boundary conditions into the problem, okay, or treat the boundary grid points. So remember that for constant values given, for which the actual variable values are given, we have to solve from the next grid point onwards. And in case the exact values are not given, if heat flux or mixed boundary conditions are given, we have to solve even at the boundary. We have to assume one extra half control volume and extra grid point to solve. Any questions?
Sir, why is it equated to zero in the last step?
This is wrong. It will not be equal. How can there be two equal to signs? this will be just equal to this. Okay. Any questions? No questions. So let us take a small break, and I think today we will be able to finish early. One more part is there, and then we'll finish. Okay. So today, up to today's class, will be the syllabus for your midterm exam. I have also uploaded a problem sheet, so you can try to look, take a look at that in the file section. It is there. I have uploaded it as an assignment problem. You can take a look at the assignment. Okay. Obviously, you don't need to submit it, but it is there. And similar type of numerical problems you can expect, or derivations of theoretical type of questions or small questions in the exam. So we'll take a break here, and we'll then continue. Let us continue. Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
You can see the screen also, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So what we have done till now, we have seen all the aspects of using finite volume method for a 1D case. For a simplistic governing equation, which has the diffusive term and the source term. Okay. So now we will see how to do it for an unsteady term also, if the unsteady term also is present. Okay. And the only term that will be left is the advective or convective term. Okay. So the effect of velocity or flow on the temperature. So that actually is an entire chapter which we will deal after the mid-sem. So, but without any, for a simple conduction type of cases, after today's class, you should be in a position to, I will give some assignment problem also, which you need to submit after the exam, say, after, say, few weeks after the exam for programming of using finite volume method, programming of simple conduction with source terms. And there are a lot of practical examples, which can be, just a second, one minute. Can you still hear me? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Today, actually, I'm taking from office, so there are a lot of interruptions. Anyway, so I actually lost track. Some person just came. Anyway, so we are discussing about unsteady equation. Okay. So what I was saying is that using unsteady or steady state diffusion equation with source term, we can tackle many real life problems. Many type of problems using CFD we can tackle using finite volume method. For example, if there is a melting process that is occurring, phase change. Okay, a lot of work is going on recently on energy related area. So one of the important area is something related to phase change materials. So we want to, if we don't want to capture the flow effect, which may become negligible for small sizes, so we can just solve using this type of equation, this equation with some source term like it is given here, even like melting solidification. Similarly, if say another problem that actually we are working on is projectile hitting a armor plate, which is a DRDO project. So there also, we don't have to consider anything, because it's just both are solid materials. We have to consider the deformation there, which is another complexity. But the energy equation remains simple like this. Okay. Similarly, there can be many hundreds of real life problems which can be tackled using this type of equation. Okay. So even without the flow. So that you after this class, you should be in a position to solve those type of problems. You can even take up one of those type of problems. You can take up as the course project. So after the mid-sem, we will have to also discuss about the course project. Okay, so that also you can take. So anyway, let us come to this equation. Rho Cp del T del T is equal to del del X of K del T del X. Again, we are considering 1D because 2D and 3D is not much different. It's just an extension of the same process. Plus SC plus SPTP, so the general equation, 1D general equation with unsteady term, diffusive term, source term. Again, the general source term, linearized source term. Okay. So for, because now there are two variables instead of one, previously only X was there, now we have T and X. So we have to do two integrations. Okay. If there are three variables, T, X and Y, we have to do three integrations. And if there are four variables, T, X, Y and Z, we have to do four integrations. Okay, not all of them are difficult, but we have to put four integrals basically. So in this case, because both T and X are variables, we will integrate with respect to X and as well as with respect to T. So this is the geometry. Okay. I will keep the geometry open here. Geometry means for that control volume. It's the same geometry. So this it should be ingrained in your mind, because every time we will be dealing with this only, even in future for the entire course. So we have the pth control volume, the pth grid point representing the pth control volume, which goes from small w to small e. So small w is the west interface, small e is the east interface. Length of the control volume is delta x. Length, remember, how do we determine? When we generate the grid using meshing. Okay. So all the values of all the dimensions are stored, but all the grid point dimensions, xy coordinate, x coordinate of the grid point, then the x coordinate of the interfaces, all these are stored in arrays. Even if you use a commercial software to generate the mesh, same thing is done internally. It looks nice to you because you are seeing the actual grid geometry, but ultimately it stores the centroids and the boundaries or the points, end points of the control volumes. So then the east neighbor is capital E, east neighboring grid point and capital W, and the east neighboring control volume will be like this, okay, up to this point. We can call this interface as small e. It's not required, I'm just writing, because you may want to know how to denote it. And this interface we must call as small ww. Writing using a mouse is difficult. So now we will integrate for this control volume, right? Because we are interested in the pth control volume. P is any general control volume, internal control volume, any general internal control volume. So going from west to east, and time is also changing. So going from t to t plus delta t, where delta t is the delta t is the time step. Okay. So from 10 second to 10.1 second, like this, we are going. So going from west to east and going from, so space step is delta x. West to east is delta x and time step is delta t. So from t to t plus delta t. Rho Cp, assuming that they are independent of t and x, rho Cp. If they are dependent, again problem becomes difficult. We have to keep them inside. Del t dt dx, okay, is equal to from t to t plus delta t, w to east, this both of these terms. So one is del x of k del t del x dx dt. And t to t plus delta t, w to east, sc plus sp tp, dx dt. Okay. So now, first integral is actually not difficult, this one. Okay. So we will assume that there is no variation along the x direction. The entire grid point is represented by the temperature tp. Okay. So this x integral can just lead us to going from west to east is delta x. So rho Cp into delta x. So only thing that will remain is from t to t plus delta t, del t del t dt. Okay. So this we can assume that the, so for this is for the pth grid point, okay, p point. So previous value, previous time step value was tp 0. And new time step value, let us write as TP1. Sometimes it is just written as TP, which is understood to be the new value because it is unknown. And TP0 is the previous time step value, it is known. So in some books you will see that it is written as TP minus TP0. Some books will write it as TP1 minus TP0. 1 is the unknown value, new value. 0 is the known value, old time step value. Okay. So rho Cp delta x, this integral. TP1 minus TP0. On the right hand side, T to del T plus delta T, let us keep it like this. Okay, so the internal part we know how to do. West to east, del del x of k del t del x dx. So this is nothing but minus k dt dx at east. K dt dx is east minus k dt dx at west. Okay, like we had done previously. Same thing. So that we had represented in terms of grid point values, assuming linear profile assumption, to be k at east minus t minus k at east into t minus tp by this distance delta xc. And similarly, this one minus kw, k at this interface, tp minus tw by delta xw. We know how to take ke and kw using harmonic means is more suitable. If you take linear average, it may work in many cases, but in some critical cases, it may not work. So this part is fine. So now only thing is that because time is varying, integral of t to d plus delta t, time is varying. At what time do we have to take this te and TP. Okay, because time is varying. At what time do we need to take this TE and TP? Okay. So how will we take this? At what time will we take this TE and TP and TWL? Huh? Any answers? How will, like, whether we should we take TP1 new value or the TP0 old value? Similarly, TE1 or TE0 or TW1 or TW0, which values to take? Give some answers. I have a lot of time today. No answer. We have already studied explicit scheme, implicit scheme in finite difference method. Same thing will be valid here. So if it is an explicit scheme, what value should we take? How will we write that term within
the in terms of TP0
and other values T0 and TW0? All the values will be zeros, right?
Yes, sir.
So all will be known values. Okay, T0 minus TP0. And if it is a fully implicit scheme, I will write T1, TP1, TW1. What about Crank-Nicolson scheme? What will I write instead of TE in Crank-Nicolson scheme?
Sir, 1 minus F times TP1 plus F times TP0.
That is for the general scheme. Crank-Nicolson is F equal to
0.5. F is 0.5.
So half TE0 plus half TE1. Okay. Similarly, half TP0 plus half TP1. Half TW0 plus half TW1. Okay. So same thing also valid here. And this for the source term, the integral is. So going from west to east, we'll assume that source term is represented by the grid point value, okay, or the entire grid. So SC plus SPTP, this integral going from west to east, dx is equal to delta, means SC delta x plus SPTP delta x. Again, the same dilemma is there, which value to be taken for TP, whether TP1 or TP0, it will depend on the scheme. Okay. So TP varies between time T and T plus delta T. We'll keep the equation open here. And we can use any of these schemes, what we have previously discussed. Same thing is valid here also, explicit scheme, implicit scheme, or Crank-Nicolson scheme. And same thing, all whatever we have discussed for explicit, implicit, and Crank-Nicolson, advantages and disadvantages, still are valid here, okay? Like the stability problem and all these things. We have discussed in detail. If you go back to the recorded class, we have discussed in detail. So, and once we use, assume any of this method, like whether we will use explicit, implicit, and Crank-Nicolson, up to us. And we have seen which cases, which are suitable, more suitable. Then we can just, accordingly, we will plug the values and the equation, final form of the equation will be different. In general, as you were saying, we can use a weight factor. F, remember, F is actually for the new value, okay? F is for the new value by normal convention. So you should not say 1 minus FTP1 plus FTP0. You should say FTP1 plus 1 minus FTP0. This is the convention. We could have taken any variable, like we could have said that 1 minus omega TP1 plus omega TP0, but this is how it is done in the standard practice. Where F can go from 0 to 1, T is equal to T plus delta T, TP dt, it will be written like this. Okay. Any for any of this. And F equal to 0 means it is fully explicit. F equal to 1 means, so F equal to 0 means this term is fully valid, this term goes to 0. F is equal to 1 means this term is not there, only this term is there. And F half means Crank-Nicolson, and in general it can be any other F also. So for the general equation, now we can write this to be, let us keep this open, very small, but if you are using a monitor, it should be fine. Mobiles, I don't recommend for classes. So rho Cp delta x by delta t, Tp1 minus Tp0 is equal to, so remember all the values. So T will now be equal to T dt, T dt will now be equal to integral of T dt will now be equal to F T1 plus 1 minus F T0. Okay. So whatever was there, one factor will come F into T1 plus 1 minus F T0. Okay. K was already there, K by delta XC. Similarly for Tp also, it will be F into Tp1 and 1 minus F Tp0. And already minus K by delta XC was there. Okay. Similarly for this case also, it will be same. Similarly, you can write F into Kw Dp1 minus Tp, Tw1 by delta XW. And here it will be 1 minus F Kw Tp0 minus Tw0 by delta XW. And for the source term, it will be constant source term, there is no issue, SC delta X, okay. So the delta T also will be there. Just let me check. It will be there. Later it gets cancelled because of the other delta T coming from the other side. Not sure, we have to, I have to check this and confirm the next slide. Should be correct actually. Also one delta tissue. So I have already cancelled this, that's why it is showing like this. Okay, it's fine, it's correct. I have already, because this delta T also should be there. That delta T I have already taken to the left hand side. That's why it is looking like this. It's correct. So otherwise there will be a delta T here and SC delta X delta T. Plus F SPTP1 delta X plus 1 minus F SPTP0 delta X delta T. So both this also will have delta T. And that left hand side was rho Cp delta X TP1 minus TP0. I have taken the delta T also to that side. Okay. So now we can just rearrange the terms, all the TP terms, TP1 terms. So we will call them as P now. Okay. We will just remove the 1 because again it is standard practice. So new terms are without any superscript, old terms are old time step values are with superscript 0. So APTP, if you take all the TP terms together, TP1 terms together, it will be APTP is equal to AEFTE plus 1 minus FTE0 plus AW FTW plus 1 minus FTW0 plus AP0 1 minus FAE. You just have to check this. It should be correct, plus minus 1 minus F AW TP0, just rearranging all these terms, okay, plus SC into delta X plus 1 minus F SP TP0 delta X. Where has this term gone? SP TP1 delta X, it has gone in within AP, AP TP, okay. So writing the current times to values, TP1 as TP and previous times to values as TP0. So here AE will be equal to KE by delta XC, AW will be KW by delta XW. And this AP0, this is the term rho CP delta X by delta T. Okay, this comes from this term, this into this TP0, which will be a known term. So that's why we put it in the source term. And AP will be F into A plus F into AW plus AP0 minus F plus SP delta X. Try this, try to derive this at home, okay? Try to derive this so that you get the same value, okay? Try to check whether we are correctly getting this or not. Should be able to do it. So ultimately, what is the final equation? It is still of the form. So now you will replace the value of F, obviously. If it is a fully implicit scheme, F I will take as 1. Fully explicit, I will take as 0. And any other scheme, I will take the whatever is the value of F. And I will be able to represent this in terms of APTP is equal to AT plus AWTW plus all whatever other terms are there in the source term B. So it will be exactly same equation that we had previously seen. Only that the coefficient values has changed. AP has changed, AE will change. Later on, means after you take F or F values of F, AW will change, but ultimately it will be the exact same form. APTP equal to AT plus AWTW plus B, where B has all the known terms and other terms are the unknown terms. And accordingly, again, you can pass it to the solver and solve it. Is it clear?
Yes.
Let this equation be here. Yes? Question? No.
No, sir.
Okay. Let us take a look at a simplified case. Okay. One dimensional. We are already looking at one dimensional unsteady heat conduction with source term zero. Okay. And we will use explicit scheme. So we could have derived, but we will not derive here. I will just write what should be the value. But you can derive for the explicit scheme and you can find that you are getting the same value. Okay. So first let us see what are the values here. F is 0, right? Explicit scheme. So this term is not there. 1 minus F into T is 0. So F is 0. So it is equal to AET is 0. Similarly, F is 0. So this term is not there. And 1 minus F is 1. So AWTW 0. AWTW 0. Okay. And AP0 is still there, where AP0 is rho CP delta X by delta T. Okay. AP0 into TP0 is still there. SC into, oh, we have ignored the source term. So SC into, these two terms are not there. Okay. So AP0 is still there. 1 minus F AE, which is F is 0, so it will become AE minus AE. And 1 minus F AW, so it is also there. Minus AW, TP0. Okay. So this is our term, where, and P also you can find out. P will be, so F is 0, so this is 0, this is 0. So P will be AP0 minus, so this is also not there. So AP0, P will also be AP0. Okay. So the final equation will be AP0 TP is equal to AT, AP is equal to AP0 basically, plus AWTW0. So all these are known from previous time step, right? So we can directly get the value, like in finite difference scheme. If you are using explicit scheme, we can directly get the value. Similarly, for implicit also, you can see what will be the value. You will see that three unknowns are there. TP is unknown, TE is unknown, TW is unknown. And similarly, for n equations, for n unknowns, you will have n equations you have to solve simultaneously. So just one thing to actually, why I have shown this is that, remember that we want all the coefficients to be positive, okay, to avoid unrealistic solution. So in this case, this is positive, this will be positive, this will be positive. This, there is a chance of being negative. So for this to be positive, AP0 minus AE minus AW should be greater than 0, okay? Or AP0 should be greater than AE plus AW. Now what is AP0? Rho CP delta X by delta T. Rho CP delta X by delta T. Okay. And what is AE? KE by delta XC. Okay, if we assume that all the control volumes are of similar size, then delta xc will be equal to delta x. The distance between two grid points will be equal to the grid point size. Okay, and if we assume that constant conductivity is there, then ke and kw will also be equal to k. Okay. So what was our equation? Okay, let it be there. So AE is equal to KE by delta XC, so it will become K by delta X, and AW will become K by delta X. So rho Cp delta X by delta T is equal, is greater than, should be greater than 2K by delta X. Okay. Now if you rearrange, you get delta T should be less than delta T, to take to the other side, should be less than rho Cp delta X square by 2K. Okay. So if this condition is valid, then there is will be no issue. So AP will be, this term will be, coefficient of TP0 will be positive. And this is the condition for stable solution for the FPC scheme. If you go back to our discussion previously, I have just stated without deriving that like for general case you need Fourier series stability analysis, that alpha delta T by delta X square should be less than equal to half. Okay, and we are getting the same thing here. Okay, so this is alpha rho Cp by K, sorry, K by rho Cp. So you get delta X square by 2 alpha should be greater than delta T. If you rearrange, you will get the same thing. Okay, same criteria. Although this has been derived with lot of limitations, that was a general condition, but we can see somehow that it is related. Delta T is related to delta X square and the diffusivity. Okay, delta X square by diffusivity. So same thing you try to find out for the implicit. There is no stability condition. I'm saying that what will be the coefficient values and other things for the implicit scheme. Okay, and let us take a look at it. At that means, again, I will not derive. I will just give you the hints, and I will expect that you will derive on your own, because the method is exactly same, and you need to practice these things on your own. Okay. So for two-dimensional unsteady heat conduction instead of one-dimensional. So one-dimensional, I have shown you the entire thing. Same process you have to follow and find out that for the two-dimensional unsteady heat conduction, what will be the discretized equation. You can assume implicit scheme or explicit scheme, whatever, and try to do it, or the general scheme. Okay. So to do that, let me describe how the control volume structure will look like. Okay. So we have to take a control volume. Now it's a two-dimensional problem. Okay. So now the control volume is, we are taking a rectangular or a square control volume. Now the east neighbor is still east, west neighbor is still west, interface is still small e and small w. So this along the x direction, it is similar. Along the y direction, the north side neighbor is denoted by capital N, north grid point, and the interface is small n, and the south side neighbor is capital S, and the interface is S. So these are again standard variables. Do not use A, B, C, D. Either use this or use I, comma J. This will become I plus 1, comma J. This will become I minus 1, comma J, where I is the variable which denotes the grid point along the x direction. And this will become ij plus 1, and this will become ij minus 1. Okay, that for programming you have to write like that. So p will be I comma j, ij basically. This will be I plus 1 j, this will be I minus 1 j, n will be ij plus 1, and s will be ij minus 1. And the control volume length along this direction is delta x, and along this direction is delta y. So it need not be a square. And the adjacent grid point distances are delta xc, like similar to previous case, and delta xw. Similarly, you can denote for the y direction. Okay, it will be delta ys and delta yl. Okay, the distances. So this is our grid structure for any general control volume P, and the equation will be rho Cp del T del T is equal to del del x of k del T del x plus del del y of k del T del y plus s. Okay, so what will you have to do in that case? How will you calculate? what will be the first step? The equation is similar, but one extra term is there. What will be the first step? Answers. Who is there? Whenever the time for attendance comes, the number increases magically. Abhijit, you are there?
Sir.
What will be the first step in finding the finite volume discretization of this two-dimensional equation? One-dimensional we have already seen. No idea, not listening, huh? Kashif? What will be the first step? Tanmay? You are there? And what should we do as a first step? Why no one is answering? I cannot hear. Tamil Selvan.
Sir, integration.
Integration, but yes, correct. Which integrations? Integration from where to where, basically. We will have to integrate, that is correct. We will have to integrate these terms. Right. So what will be the integrals?
Sir, for x direction, we need to integrate it from west to east, and for the y direction, is from south to north. So we will get two new terms, like previously we had TE
that
and T.
That is true, but you don't have to integrate only west to east. Means you have to integrate the entire equation. Remember, see this term, okay? So it is not that only for the temporal time we had integrated with for time, and only for the spatial term, means x direction term, we had integrated with x. All the equation we have to integrate with both time and x. So in this case, all the terms we have to integrate with both x, y and t. Okay. So what will be the values of the integral, means extent of the integral? So this will be triple integral. Okay. Like this. For all the terms, it will be triple integral. What will be the extent of those triple integrals for each case? I mean, for all cases, the extent is same, but what will be the value? For x direction, what is the value?
So for x direction, it will be from west to east.
Yes, correct.
For y direction, it will be from south to north.
North, correct.
And for t. Time variable, it will be from t to t plus delta t.
Good. So that is the case. So that we have to do. Okay. Otherwise, the entire problem is similar. So I am not doing it. I am leaving it as an exercise for you. So APTP should be equal to AT plus AWTW. So now, because you will have four neighboring points, you will get an equation like this. You will be integrating with respect to y. You will get four neighboring points. APTP equal to AT plus AWTW. Plus ANTN plus ASTS plus B, where these will be the values. Okay, try to do it on your own. as an exercise, where A is equal to KE delta Y by delta XC, AW, KW, delta Y by delta XW. Okay. So whenever you are taking the X terms, integrating them, the Y direction automatically will become delta Y, integral over the Y, because we are assuming that the flux here or anywhere along this direction is constant. So the entire X direction flux we multiply by delta Y. So similarly, you can find out all this kn, an is equal to kn by delta, kn delta x by delta yn, s ks delta x by delta ys, ap0, b and ap. Okay. I leave it as an exercise for you. Okay. Implicit, explicit both to do. And you check at least the implicit you do, and check explicit is very easy. Okay. And if you are interested, although I will not be giving you any assignment problem on 3D, but if you want to study or want to learn more thoroughly, you can even do the 3D, explicit and implicit, okay? And you can take a look at the book. I think the answers are there also for the 3D part. Exactly same thing, but now the points are denoted as, two more points are there. One inside the screen, which is called as bottom, B, and one outside this screen in this direction, which is known as top, T, okay? So T and B will be two more neighboring points. So we'll have six neighboring points, east, west, north, south, top, bottom. And accordingly, we will have the equation APTP equal to AET plus AWTW plus ANTN plus ASTS plus ATTT plus ABTB plus B. Okay. And again, the same process, n number of equations, n number of unknowns, we can use the same method to solve. Okay. So with this, we will stop today's class here. And up to this point is your syllabus for the midterm exam. In the Wednesday's class, we will start a new topic, numerical solution of these equations, the equations that we are obtaining, how to solve them. And then after the midterm, we will continue and we will then go into the last term that is left, which is the convective term. And then Navier-Stokes equation. Then finally, towards the end, we will see how to discretize for irregular geometries, how to find the equations for the irregular geometries. Means if there are triangles, instead of this type of nice rectangles or squares. So how to tackle that? Because for triangles, the flux will not be in the normal direction. So we have to see all those cases. Any questions? Exam is of 60 marks. Anyway, we have another class. Exam will be of 60 marks. And typically for this type, not much numerical problems can be given. But if there are any numerical problems, it will be similar to those I have already uploaded in the portal as an assignment, which you don't have to submit. Keep in mind that you have to do the programming assignment. Although I have not yet posted it formally, but you will have to do it and submit it. Maybe I will extend the deadline by one more week. So maybe first week of October, you have to submit. Notes should be sufficient for the exam, but you have to have a clear understanding to answer short questions. If there are no questions, we will end the class here. Okay. And I will take the attendance directly. Thank you.